So I'll do a count to lead it in. One, two, three, four. Prejudice to guitars that have plastic backs. Tighter sound. Tighter sound. Sound. It drifts away from the norm. Sounds very much like a dreadnought. Tighter sound. Tighter sound. Feel free to experiment around a bit. Things I should mention now is that, first off, neither the rhythm through there nor the improvising part over the rhythm were what I would consider the ideal, but I think you get the point nonetheless.
Hey, what's up, everyone? How y'all doing? Names. Michael Mark, Loco Joe, Billy Novak. How y'all doing? John Hart, Dale's here, Bluegrass Prodigy. Ben, what's up? Glad everyone can make it this week. You just listened to the Discord perform. You liked it. That's what I like to hear, Russ. Yeah, it was a good one. It was a really good one. Dale was just asking... sorry, Dale. Loco was just asking about my break from that video. And I actually already wrote it down for someone. Someone already asked for it, and I transcribed it, which is surprising that I got asked for it so quickly. But I'll show it to you, Loco. I assume I'm going to put it on the website sometime soon. But here's the break. I'm not sure I can play it that fast. I took a bunch of takes. I sat down. maybe for an hour, and I grinded it out. It took a while. That's my first A. Here's my second A. It's my second A. And then here's that B part. Play it down the octave for my second B. That's my break from the Bluegrass Coalition video. It was a fun one. My favorite part of the break is the C sharp right here. Not a note that anyone would expect. That's how you get them. You hit them with the C sharp. John's still working on those C-licks, yeah? Nice, man. G-licks and C-licks, those top 10 videos. Yeah, those are some old videos. Those are some classics. I'm glad you're still grinding through those, man. Yeah, those 10 G-licks are really cool. Every once in a while, I go back and look at them because it's kind of like a snapshot of my playing. You know, it's how I played in that, like, one little moment. That was such a cool break. Thanks, Michael. I'm glad you like it. Hey, what's up, Travis? We got Hillbilly Guy. I appreciate the mini pearl quote. You need like a price tag on your hat. AZ's here. Howdy, y'all, from Prescott AZ. Not just Marcel's, but everybody's hometown. Did you ever see that dopey YouTube video they made? Maybe I shouldn't say dopey, but there's a little like everybody's hometown song and they made a little video for it. It's very cheesy. It's gotta be old now. Yeah, I got those first five bars right at least. Nice, Loco. Nice. See, that's the exchange. I only transcribed like two bars of your break, so, you know, we're even. Hopefully you guys got another break. We'll get to that in a second, man. I appreciate the suggestion, though. We'll listen to it. Where was the C sharp? Justin. I love it. If you listen to my last A, it's the second to last measure in my A part. I'll play it for you so you can hear it. So I have these like intervals and these strumming right here. And I'm rounding the turn to my last four bars of A part. Yeah. That note right there. It's literally right before the break ends. That's where it is, Justin. I produced that cheesy video myself. No way. Oh, you're just kidding. Man, I was gonna be so excited, man. I don't know how old you are, but I feel like that video is a little old. Put the Discord address up, please. Yeah, I can do that. One of the mods can do it too. We'll see who gets to it first. You should be able to follow that link and join up with us. Let's see. How do you approach writing a break as opposed to improvising one? Oh, they're kind of, I mean, it's kind of an iterative process. So a lot of times I'll, you know, improvise a couple measures that I like and I'll be like, oh, how can I develop that theme? So you'll find things that you enjoy that you improvised. And then you're like, how do I build on that idea? How do I make it a bigger idea? I don't know if I can find an idea in this break. I don't know if I can see that far back and remember what I was thinking. There's certainly kind of this enclosure half step thing happening in that break, which I'll point out to you guys. So, yeah, right. So all these little moments where I'm circling a chord tone. So, you know, this is above where I want to be, this is below where I want to be, and this is the note I want to play, right? I'm kind of circling that F sharp, and then here I'm circling that E. I'll play it too. So you hear this, right? I'm circling the note, and then moving down, and I keep going, right? It keeps happening. And all together. And so that became like a thematic thing that I developed. I'm sure that when I was first just improvising takes that I only did that once. And then I thought that was cute. So I, you know, came up with a way to do it for more time. That's a pretty common way to do things. Oh, and I it's not the same thing, but I kind of reference it in a way. Those are kind of cute ways to point out the same kind of shtick. And then for my first B part, I'm kind of going through some different cliches. This is very, all of this is very blues. I'm actually bending into an E major chord over an E minor chord. That's why it sounds crunchy. Blues phrasing. This is a bebop lick that I play a lot. I use it in like gypsy jazz scenarios too. This is like kind of like this, you know, broadly speaking, like Latin cliche that people use a lot. A lot of times people call that a line cliche. Just happens to fit really well right there. This lower down thing is kind of like playing like a funk player, right? This is kind of like a chromatic, I don't know. It's not really anything. It's a very chromatic interpretation of the B7. And the rest kind of makes sense. It's kind of bluegrassy stuff. That's kind of the breakdown of the break, if you will, though. This first passage is very arpeggio-driven, too. You can see that I couldn't get the note that I wanted right here, so this turns it into like a G6 right here. It's cute. So on and so forth. Before I forget, how are you, Marcel? I'm good, dude. Things have been really good. This is, for those of you that don't know, I teach 1 week, so I have a full schedule of teaching lessons, and then I'm like off the next week. So I make videos, I produce content, I like work on the website, I do all that stuff. So this is my off week, right, where I'm kind of doing office work and not teaching every day. So I'm doing great. It can be kind of demanding to just hop from video call to video call. This kind of gives me a break. Marcel, explain in detail how you position your right hand to pick clean. Been watching your right hand. Ah, yeah. So you tend to see, like if you just position your pick different ways, you get a really bright tone back here. Right? You get a really warm tone towards the middle of your guitar. And so generally there's this region kind of here that you see bluegrass musicians play in, and I'm no different. It's like this is the acceptable region, where it's like a little brighter right here at the edge of the sound hole, and it warms up a little bit over the sound hole. And you'll see me kind of like pick my place where I want to be here. So if I want like a sweeter sound, I'll play mid sound hole. Brighten it up, all I do is shift my hand back. You probably hear that. And it's really just that little region that I'm picking where I want to be. In terms of picking cleanly, man, that is an accuracy problem. One of my favorite exercises for that is this Trey Hensley workout he gave me, where you play 3, 4, 5 on, you know, E, A, and D. And you play down, up, down, and then you move that to the next string set. So now I have 3, 4, 5, same frets on strings A, D, and G, and now I play up, down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up, next one, down, up, down, up, and you go through those. And then you can do it setting. Great exercise to work on your pick accuracy. Anyway, those are just some ideas to help you out, man. What's up, Mason? I'm glad you're here. Do you record while you're improvising and pick out the parts you want? Well, generally, if I'm like recording for like a session, like I'm recording breaks on someone's record or for like the Bluegrass Coalition thing, I, in my recording software, I set a region to loop so I can just roll through take after take after take, and like find ideas that I like and then develop them in the next pass. And eventually, maybe I might have like a clear idea of what I want to do for like, you know, like 80% of the break. And that's certainly what happened with the Bluegrass Coalition one, where like, you know, 70 to 80% of it is like ideas that I like and I've kind of warmed up to, and I'm more or less hitting them the same way. And then maybe 20% of it, I don't know what's going to come out. It's going to be improvised until I hit a take that I like. And that's kind of just like a writing process. Like most of the time when I'm doing that, I'm not trying to nail a take, you know, like I know that those first, you know, handful of times that I play through it, I'm just kind of feeling out the room. And then, you know, later on I get more serious and I'm like, all right, let's try to play it cleanly. Let's try to nail it. If it's my own personal recording, I will be careful about, you know, like recording every take, because maybe there is an idea from early on that I really like. And I'm not against, you know, splicing things and doing a little editing magic. Bela Fleck has a great take on that. Someone asked Bela Fleck about editing in the recording studio, and he said that if you took the band on the road and they played the songs for like 2 or 3 weeks, they're gonna like blow the recording out of the water, right? They're gonna be so much better at playing the tunes after they've gigged them for a little bit. So yeah, when you're recording it in the studio, why don't you, you know, use a little bit of the studio magic to like get it at that level? Because otherwise the recording is going to be way worse than the live show. So maybe you can balance them out by cheating a little bit in the recording studio. By the way, I don't like that word when people say they cheat in recordings, because you can't win at music, so you can't cheat at music. Anyway. What's up, everyone? When I'm writing songs, that's normally I'm not recording. Every once in a while, when I find something that I like, I'll record it on my phone. But when I'm writing stuff, I normally kind of do it all up here. We got Texas in the house. Thanks for stopping by, Abel. Everyone's saying hi to everyone. Hey, Dale, noticed you were left-handed. First person I've ever seen playing left-handed. Very good. Is Dale left-handed? I guess I can't picture the footage well enough in my head. Maybe he is. Any advice for keeping your hand floating over the strings while playing towards the sound hole? I find myself still resting on the bridge from time to time, but that can often be too bright. Yeah, you know, if you're over the sound hole a little bit, there's no reason why the meat of your hand here couldn't touch the low E string sometimes. Because it's not about having like a static, constant, like contact point, right? The contact can be like variable. So if you open up your hand a little bit, maybe you can just touch a little bit of the pick guard. Don't brace, don't apply pressure, but just touch and feel where you are, and then maybe touch the low E string a little bit. You're just looking for reference points. Don't want to lock in anywhere, but it's okay for those points to be dynamic. Like, I like touching my bridge pins, but I'm not always touching them, right? Sometimes my hand is a little more free-floating, sometimes it's a little bit closer, but I'm never applying pressure. That's the thing. Cool, but which slant on pick bottom or bridge up? I've been trying both ways, but very cool. Oh, the pick slant, like forward or back? Well, if you think about flat picking, they kind of set up their hand, these acoustic guitar players, so that way on the low E, they have a really flat attack. And as the arc of your arm travels, you tend to get more of like a forward slant when you get to that high E string. And the pick tends to flatten out as you get to that low E. And it's just how your arm works, right? Very flat. And as I move higher up, you can see my arm is now going at this angle. So I naturally have a little bit of a pick slant. If I tried to keep this pick slant and go to lower strings, my elbow has to climb up. That's no good. So that's kind of what happens. If anything, it's like the most gentle forward slant. If you're talking about slanting this way, right, whether or not I'm going up or down like that, it tends to be pretty flat, pretty neutral. In every pick stroke, I'm creating an arc. I don't favor one side like you might see rock musicians do. They might favor this way or favor that way. It's kind of an arcing motion for most bluegrass guitar players. When you begin to write a break, do you start writing with the melody in mind? Or do you have certain go-to licks that you open with? Yeah, if I'm writing a break, it kind of depends on what everyone else has done. So, you know, I recorded my break for the Bluegrass Coalition thing last. And I didn't see a lot of people doing like arpeggio work for the A section. And so that's what I started with. It's a lot of chord tones, arpeggios, as opposed to a linear line, right? Everyone kind of played the melody in this linear snake kind of line. And I didn't want to do that because that's what everyone else did. So I started with this like little more arpeggio based thing where I'm playing like the chord expanded across multiple strings. Do I eventually play a linear line? Yeah. But it's kind of like, you know, they bob and you weave, right? You want it to be interesting. So depending on what the melody does, you make that interesting choice. With fiddle tunes, though, I mean, most of the time the melodies are really good, right? They've been like whittled down by time to like just the essentials, like a solid, great melody. So yeah, of course you want to touch the melody and honor the melody. It depends, though. Depends on the situation. Hey, what's up, Jacob? Thanks for stopping by. Dale says, I'm left-handed. I'm not seeing anybody else's comments. Is Dale trapped in the void? I don't think so. I don't know what's going on, Dale. Either you're left-handed or every bit of footage you have ever seen is mirrored. I think it might be mirrored now. If Dale doesn't know he's left-handed. Hey, Marcel, what keeps you interested and motivated in guitar after transcribing and learning so many tunes? That's a good question, man. I mean, have you ever heard the saying that boring people get bored? Only boring people get bored? It's kind of like that, where you're always trying to like reinvent and try new things that interest you on the instrument, right? You're always trying to find the unexpected. So the moment that you stop doing that is when you potentially get boring. You get bored. So no, I don't really get demotivated necessarily. I normally just change my perspective. I normally just like work in a different direction. So like if you go back on my Instagram, you can find times when I was really interested in like the fingerstyle thing. I was doing some like, you know, jazz standards, and I was doing some like video game themes in the fingerstyle for a while. I was doing the chord melody thing. There's a video of me doing that. That's Dream as Your Wish, Your Heart Makes from Cinderella. You know, so like I find these different things that kind of intrigue me. Sometimes that's flat picking and bluegrass. Sometimes it's not. Sometimes it's like, you know, telly country stuff. But I just try to immerse myself in all these different, you know, like facets of guitar playing. Sometimes I'm just into like scale patterns and technique stuff, you know, so I'm just thinking about like, and I'm like, what does that look like in another scale position? You know, that kind of stuff. Haven't practiced those in a while. I have a camera in my eyeball and play in front of a mirror. That's an interesting situation you got there, Dale. You fly on them videos you made about phrasing. Advanced G and C looks amazing smooth. The more I watch, the more it's revealed, bro. Thank you so much. No problem, John. Those videos are really fun. Some of those looks are really hip. That's actually in the most recent, you know, like duplicated video that I did. It's in the... I guess it's in the tone, speed, and volume video. I play Cherokee Shuffle with me on mandolin and me on guitar, kind of right here on my desk. And one of the licks that I play 10 advanced licks. I don't remember. I got out of it in some way to get to the E minor chord in the B part of Cherokee Shuffle. Like this. Right? I don't remember exactly what it was, but something like that. Let's see. I did it. I caught up to your questions. You guys can't ask questions fast enough. That's how good I am at answering questions. Come at me. Try to ask me a question. Your favorite, you said in the video. Did I say that? You know, at the time, it probably was my favorite. I used to play in a duo, and we would play Cherokee Shuffle, and that was a signal that I would give. I can't remember if that lick was the signal for the end of the tune or for us to go into like another tune, like we played two tunes as a set. But I used to play that lick to signal the other guy, you know, hey, we're going on to the next thing. Takamondo? Is that what that says? Thanks for subscribing. This is not my best playing day. I feel like I'm whiffing all these. That's all right. There's always different avenues to explore. It's funny that there's only this handful of notes and everything's been played, yet new things still emerge. Totally. Does this mean a Cherokee Shuffle lesson is coming soon? You know, we had one kind of scripted. I don't know if we ever finished it, that script, but we're talking about doing a fiddle tune lesson on that. You know, because I did those two for Blackberry Blossom and Red-Haired Boy, and we wanted to do more of those. I think there's a script for that I should make. Do you ever transcribe any stuff on the electric? I would love to learn Peaceful Easy Stuff by the Eagles. It's beautiful stuff. Man, I feel like we did one time on stream. I transcribed like a Joe Mathis break or something. But no, not regularly. Mostly because I'm not a great electric guitar player. I got that like classic bluegrass thing where you try to play bluegrass licks on the telly. It just doesn't work. I do some of the bending and some of the neat tricks. In fact, on the album we put out last year, there's a bunch of electric guitar on there. I take some like 80s style guitar solos. I take some bendy country guitar solos too. Check it out if you haven't listened to it. It's called Traitor. It's on all popular streaming services. Are you a Pat Metheny fan? Not really, but Wyatt Rice is. As exposed by Original Untitled, I believe it's got a big Pat Metheny quote in it. I think that's true. Those are great. They really helped me out early on. Yeah, we should make more of those videos. I assume that's what you're talking about, those fiddle tune videos. We definitely should make more of those. We were thinking about rolling those into something else. You guys will find out. You'll find out in the future. I can play Hotel California from the Eagles. Well, aren't you just the bluegrass prodigy there, Dale? I know it's not bluegrass, but how about Glenn Campbell's break on Gentle on My Mind? Only if we do that one live version. You know that, I've talked about this before. There's this one really good solo. And I feel like the video is even called like Best Solo or something. But he takes a great break on it. Yeah, Gentle on My Mind, terrific guitar break, this one. Terrific guitar break.
Elton Jarvis.
I think this one has the best. I think whoever titled it was correct.
I'll play one.
It's a sweet little break. It's a shame he's plugged in. It probably sounded better if that guitar was mic'd. That's a great little break, though. Marcel, do you try different picks or stick with one favorite? Yeah, that's a fun question. I am a blue chip boy. I normally play blue chips. Oh, can you see those? There you go. I normally play the TAD 50 or the TAD 60. This video not endorsed by Blue Chip. For the last maybe like year, I want to say I've been almost exclusively playing the 60, but every once in a while I play the 50 still. There's a couple other picks that are lying around. Every once in a while I use them. There's some tortoiseshell picks and stuff, but I like the Blue Chips the best. Yes, we should do this. It's a cool break. Have you transcribed Doc Watson's Don't Let Your Deal Go Down? I don't know if we've done that one. I don't think we have. Trey Hensley, Steamboat Whistle Blues, Intro Break. Ah, the suggestions are rolling in. It's time to move on to transcribing, it sounds like. All right, let's see. Let's get this whole thing ready. Very quickly, before we do this, let's listen to Glenn Campbell shred Back Home Again in Indiana, because that is just one of my favorite videos of him.
Oh, I can see right now.
All right, here we go.
And I dream about the moonlight on the Wabash as I dream of my Indiana home.
Crushes.
Back home again in Indiana. Oh, I dream of the place I used to be.
What a monster. So cool. very cool. Let's see. Probably one of the most underrated guitar players of all time. I mean, based on that performance, yes, totally. I've been wanting Whispers of the North for a while, too. You know, we transcribed a live version of that, and I think it's in my unfinished folder. I don't think we ever totally got to the end of it. But we could look at the live, or not the live version, we could look at the album version. Let's see what we got. I can't resist the lure of the Tony Rice transcription.
Whispers of the North.
It's such a pleasure to transcribe Tony Rice because his playing is so clean. Like in those last couple Glenn Campbell videos that we watched, even though the breaks are great, like playing's great, they're just not like crisp. They're not just like perfect. And you know, this Tony Rice break, you can hear like every note just perfectly. Let's see. Kenneth coked out of his mind. Possibly. that is ridiculous for his tone to be that clean. Any mistake would have been highlighted. I know, Glenn Campbell, wild. Let's do this one. Let's do the Whispers of the North because, because Michael Mark asked for it and Jacob Stouffer seconded it. So let's make that one happen. Banjo for Life says, hello. Hey, man, how you doing? We're about to jump into the our first transcription of the night. I think it's going to be a long one, but that's all right. Let's try to figure out where Tony's capo. So if I was Tony, I'd probably capo 3 and do the A minor shape. Don't think he's playing an open C minor. I would guess capo 3. And I would also imagine that the first couple seconds of this are going to betray whether or not I'm correct. Because he kind of does this ascending line, which should probably tell us. Let's find out. Man, what is that? It kind of feels like it's a slide, though. I guess it could be that. G-shaped capo 2? Could be. Molly Tuttle has a good break for Gentle on My Mind. I think we transcribed that one. Are we feeling it like this? You're saying capo 2? And that chord that it lands on, is this like B flat minor? I don't know about that. I don't know about that, guys. Let's start it like this, and if we change our mind about the capo thing, we can figure it out. I think it might be, just so we can get started. We could listen to the rest of the song and hem and haw over it, and that would be fine. But just so we can get started. I hear that slide right there, which makes me think it's like that. And I hear that kind of like root note right there. Something like that. I guess we should fix our key signature, yeah. Maybe not. Though some of those licks sounded like G licks. They do. Triplet, hammer on pull off. We're going back up. I don't know if that note is right. So this sounds like a missed note, and then I'm hearing like this. Could be on a different string. Pull off. Oh, I don't know why I just wrote that off by a fret. Whoops, excuse me. He normally plays that lick right there. So I think we might be on the right track. This lick is normally played right there. Let's get some of our labels in place. Break starts. A minor capo 3, we all agree, cool. Is it that one? It is. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Pull offs. This is an escape note. I gotta try the offer drum beats. In Guitar Pro? I think so. I don't know. I've never used them. I've noticed Billy Strings doesn't use a drummer. Bluegrass bands, no drummers, man. I don't think that was a pull-off. It sounded like you picked it. Taking some time right here, back and forth, before we go up. Fun blue note right there. A little bit of that, like, harmonic minor, maybe. Just checked, all my videos are mirrored. Mr. Southdale. Like that. That's right. Let's see, we got four measures. Yeah, we're on the third line. Back up, maybe like that. I wonder if he's shifted somewhere else. I'm having trouble grabbing that hammer on. What notes are those? Ah, that makes sense. So it's like right here. I just didn't catch that, man. Couldn't catch that one. All right, syncopated. Da 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 da. Yeah, they have a bunch of different instruments, and you can tab out any part you want, but I think it's all MIDI sounds. Yeah, of course it's MIDI. They have a sample pack that if you go to the sounds setting under the track tab, you can switch between, I think that it's RSE and MIDI, and the RSE is like the Guitar Pro sound library, and MIDI is like your built-in MIDI sounds. Yeah, you definitely have to tinker with the sound to make it sound right. There, I mean, it's simulated, right? It's never gonna sound like a real guitar, but it sounds good enough. Why is that? I guess we'll just write rest. I feel like I hear a little slide down, but it doesn't quite make sense to me unless this takes place higher up the neck. Fast on beat one. This is a classic Tony lick, but I don't know it. Maybe something like that. Maybe like that. Like that, probably. Minor third. I don't know, I'm not sure what that note was. I think this is a hammer on pull off. So that phrase works slightly differently. It's like this. That's definitely way up the neck. Comes in on the and of one. I'm a bit late with this, Marcel, but don't forget to update the currently transcribing. Oh, thank you so much. Yes, gold star. Gold star for you. I always forget. There we go. Starts down there on the six, so down just there. Having trouble. Tough. Yeah, okay, let's go with that. This note is the one that I'm unsure of. If you got opinions, let them be heard. Why did I do that? It's like that. Oh, yeah. It's kind of hip. Okay, what is that? Let's see, 5. Oh. Writing stupid things. There we go. Makes me think of like shadows or something. Yeah. Oh, by the way, Coalition Video was amazing. Great job, everybody. Let's take a little bit of a break. Viewership is plummeting as I transcribe. Oh, by the way, Coalition Video was amazing. Great job, everybody. Y'all got some crazy talent. Maybe I'll try to get on the next one. Oh, hopefully, yeah, you got to get on the next one, man. For sure. It'll be good. What's up, Josh? The first note is a major sixth. Oh, yeah, that's what you think it is down there? We'll figure that out. Thanks for that, Michael Mark. Yeah, great video, everybody. Y'all are amazing. Some real cool licks in there. Yeah, Jacob, why aren't you in the video? Just in, let's see. So, yeah, D note. When I can pick as fast as y'all, I'm starting to scratch 100, though. Yeah, I think the next one, I mean, I don't know, we'll see what everyone decides. But I think the next one should probably be a little bit slower, too. I heard from a lot of people that 120 was pushing it. Aubrey, what's up? I remember your name from last time. Thanks for coming to hang out again. I'm a little intimidated by you guys in the Coalition video. Y'all are giants, and I'm a nobody. Yeah, we're gonna rough you up. We'll fight you in a Waffle House parking lot. Nah, man. You're welcome. Everybody's welcome. Like I said, I think we're going to do, assuming everyone agrees, but I think we might do a more mellow one, just so more people can participate. We'll have like 30 breaks in a row next time. Tennessee Waltz with 20 full-form solos. Yeah, exactly. I don't think that's going to happen. But we got a little bit of time. I mean, the kind of the soft idea that was talked about with the Bluegrass Coalition was that we would do one kind of every season. So we had, you know, kind of we had the winter one. And I guess this would be like more like the spring one early in the year. But I assume the next one will be like our summer one. And we'll just kind of do it like that. So it might be a little bit of time. Waffle House parking lot? Yeah, man. Have you not seen the video where I talk about fighting in the Waffle House parking lot? Jeez, does anyone remember what video that is? I want to say it's the Sierra Hole one. Let's see. This is working out. I think I joke about the Waffle House parking lot in this one. Yeah, there it was. You are in a Waffle... Yeah. Guess what, dude? I get it. You want to throw down like me and you are in a Waffle House parking lot. But let's not do that
And instead, why don't you just accept that I wrote it like that a couple of weeks ago, and I'm probably not going to change it now because I'm lazy.
Classic lessons with Marcel moments. 120 was rough, man. It took me a good 40 to 50 takes total before I got one I was happy with. Yeah, I feel you, man. Like I said, I wrote out a break this time. Something slow enough for me, says Russ. Do I get to eat at the Waffle House before you guys give me the business? Yeah, totally, man. It's when you're going back to your car. You're full of food at this point. Ryan says, your break was cool, Joe. Worth the effort for sure. Yeah, I liked Loco's break, too. It was super syncopated. I was considering giving you the award for most syncopated, but then I saw that cool leg. Marcel, you have a great head of hair. Why do you always wear a hat? Just for you, man. We're gonna let all those grays out. Look at that. Look at that beautiful head of hair. Appreciate the Elvis do. Look at that. Look at the curl. Rockabilly kids across the globe are quaking. Did I tell you guys about my hair? Did I tell you my hair story? I can't remember if I told this on stream. But I will tell it now. So, my wife was at, Target or something, and she bought one of those, like, head scratcher things, you know, that you, like, put on the back of your head and it scratches your head. And I just went to town with that thing. And, I never had one before, and I was scratching my head with that thing, right? And, I gave myself a bald spot. I had a no joke, maybe like, you know, dime-sized bald spot from the head scratcher. And I was like, oh no, it's happening. You know, my hair is going. But it grew back. Everything's fine. I no longer have a bald spot. But yeah, there was a time when I just totally ripped out my hair. And it was like maybe Thanksgiving last year. I gave myself a bald spot. And then I had to wear the hat. There was no taking the hat off. So I had a perfect little random bald patch of my head. It was so funny. I like the faster ones. I like challenge. It helps me as a player. Yeah, it's fun to a point, you know. If we had done this thing at 160, it would have been rough. I'm not sure I would have even done a break. Okay, I figured out the note. It's an F note, actually. Man, see, F didn't sound right to me. Oh, I mean, assuming you're not saying F relative to capo. Let us know the fiddle tune in advance so that we can practice for a month or so. Well, I mean, we'll see what everyone decides in the Discord. That's where it happens. You got a Huddle House, not a Waffle House. I don't know what that is, man. Is this like some rare off-brand Waffle House I'm not familiar with? What's the next Coalition song that we should do? I would also like to get in on it. We decide in the Discord, man. Get in the Discord. That's where the conversation will happen. Marcel looking like a dark-haired Brian Setzer. Yeah, that's it, man. I mean, dark-haired except for all those gray ones. And it looks like my hair is just catching the lights. No, those are grays. we're going like George Clooney over here. all right, let's keep going on this transcription. I think this stream is becoming a real ones only stream. We got like the deep cut Tony transcription and we're just talking about the Bluegrass Coalition. That's cool with me, gang. But y'all haven't heard of Huddle House? I don't know about Huddle House, man. But well, I'll learn now. What is this? You guys know about this? Wait, does everyone else know about this and I don't? This is Huddle House. I'm not familiar with this phenomena. It says they cover North Carolina. Where's the closest one to me? Okay, I do not live close to a Huddle House. Yeah, this would be just a little bit of a trek for me. I think they're all in like the southern part of the state. But I appreciate the recommendation. Bootleg Waffle House. I think it's slightly nicer than Waffle House. What? Are you implying that Waffle House isn't nice? I hadn't even heard of Waffle House. Then again, I'm not from the U.S. You know, the real Waffle House is the friends we made along the way, Loco. Whoa, only losers eat at Waffle House. I'll have you know that I live like, you know, 30 seconds away from a Waffle House. We have Huddle and Waffle House in Kentucky. Oh, you get to choose. Jacob, going either way on that one. I like them both. Only have a Huddle House in Vidalia. Have to go to Savannah or Statesboro for a Waffle House. Oh, so you gotta like, you know, you gotta make a day of it. You got to the Waffle House. Aubrey lives at Huddle House. I didn't even know that existed. DJ Khalid at a Waffle House here in Texas. Whoa. Ben, that is, was he on a jet ski? Was he lost in Texas on a jet ski at a Waffle House? Only bad thing about Huddle House is that they have Pepsi products. I drink Diet Coke. Isn't Pepsi like a North Carolina thing? How's the sweet tea? First time in a Waffle House, we were in Mount Airy and it was close to freezing and they had the air conditioning on. See, that sounds like the true, authentic Waffle House experience. Now, you know it's a real Waffle House if you have your friend, you know, like, worm his way behind the jukebox and plug it back in so you can listen to George Jones songs at 3 in the morning. That is how you Waffle House. Shout out to Jack. Thanks for plugging in that jukebox. They're both pretty grimy, but you don't get drunk and take off your clothes at Huddle House. That you may have said it as succinctly as you possibly could, Jacob. I once saw an employee get into a verbal altercation with an employee at a Waffle House, and the employee threatened to throw hot coffee at the customer, and also picked up a handful of butter knives and was like yelling at the customer until they left. And then my food came, and it was all wrong. None of it was what I ordered. And then I just kind of left without paying. Didn't really eat. It was very confusing. it was kind of scary, honestly. And then I just got out of there. I don't know what was happening. But I didn't want to incur the wrath of, you know, employee or other customer. And I just dipped. I fled. But the George Jones was good. All right, let's get back to transcribing this thing. Unless anyone has some, you know, glorious nuggets about Waffle House history. Still looking for answers on that note. Give me a string and a fret. Okay, where is this going? I'm dead. That's exactly what you get at Waffle House. It is. This conversation topic is making me crave waffles now at 1 a.m. That can't be good for my health. Ah, man, if you're American, you can eat waffles whenever you want. get a couple of those, like, freezer waffles. Just pop them in a toaster. You're good to go, man. That's basically what Waffle House is anyway. I put money in the jukebox and play the Waffle House songs as I walk out the door. Are you talking about the, you know, isn't there one where, like, the guy's in love with the lady that works at Waffle House? I think I know the one you're talking about. I was actually the drunk guy with my clothes off in my example. Don't tell me that, man. Ryan says, there's a saying in the Gulf Coast area that a hurricane isn't bad until the Waffle House shuts down. That's probably true. That's a good indicator of where society's at. Is the Waffle House still open? My buddy went to Waffle House in the middle of the night and they asked if he wanted his peanut butter waffle wasted. Could it be fifth string, eight Fred? Yeah, so I was thinking about that, right? If it's like the root note of the chord. I didn't hear that though. We can listen again though. I'm glad that you're in on this mystery, Michael. If anything, I'll just figure it out when the stream's over. I just don't want to bore anyone. They proceeded to bring it out with, no joke, a giant mound of peanut butter chips. Whoa. So this like a secret menu item you can order? I'm glad that everyone has a Waffle House story. If not several Waffle House stories. There's this dude that works at the Waffle House by my house. This real wiry dude. Who's got this very like excitable kind of scary way that he talks. He just talks about how terrible work is and how he's getting called in to talk to the manager and he's probably about to get fired and blah, blah, blah. And he just loudly complains while he's like taking your order and like making food and doing whatever. He's just there like shouting about how awful work is. And you're just sitting there casually eating your waffles. It's a real experience. I can't say I frequent the Waffle House, you know, often. I'm not always at the Waffle House, but if I am, I hope that that guy's there because he really brings a lot to the experience. My pastor got stranded in a snowstorm one time and had to spend the night in the Waffle House parking lot. You could spend your night inside the Waffle House, man. That's the best time to go. You're the only one there. It's the middle of the night. People are throwing knives around. Highly recommend. College was a bad influence on me. Yeah, we don't talk about the college years, man. I went there on Black Friday to Huddle House once, and it was insane. A kid threw up. One waitress wasn't working at all. It took forever to get a table, and one waitress served people a dirty cup. Dude, that Huddle House is sounding a lot more like Waffle House. Because those are all things you expect at the Waffle House. When I think of like a classy Waffle House, I think of like Denny's. You know, like Denny's is a place where like, you know, like after, you know, like after like a baseball game or something, you could have like a bizarre Denny's dinner. Like I can imagine that happening. But after like a baseball game, you know, in like third grade, going to like a Waffle House seems weird. Like I can imagine families having a good time at Denny's despite it still being like, you know, low tier. Hi, Marcel. Hey, what's up, man? You're walking into our conversation about Waffle House. You might not have experience with the Waffle House. You're not in the U.S., are you? Hey, what was that? Thanks for subscribing. I can't read your name, but thank you for subscribing. I think I hear this. Something like that. I'm just trying to pop in every once in a while, get some quick transcribing done. What about Shoney's? I'm embarrassed to say that my only experience with Shoney's is from Rick and Morty. oh man, you ain't seen the Denny's around here. Oh, you got some like, you got like a good Denny's? The Denny's serving up the good. Denny's is where you go when you're sober and you go to Waffle House when you're drunk. Yeah, Shoney's seems like it's in a almost like a higher tier. You know, that's like, you know, Shoney's is like, feels more like Applebee's or something to me. Is that correct? Could you take a look at the guitar break on the Sonoran Dogs version of Rosewood? Break starts at 2:40. Thanks. Gwen, things are going a little slowly around here today. Could we get to that? Maybe. Are we also really dragging our feet on this Whispers of the North and talking about Waffle House a lot? Yeah. Yeah, we are. Let's see if we can get this one across the finish line before we take on something else. The rough, rough Denny's. I got you, man. I got you. Man, we had a Denny's when I was in high school that we would hang out at a lot in the middle of the night. I think it's because it was just kind of the only thing that was open. There's a couple restaurants, I guess, that were open, but we would just always be around, you know, screwing around, driving around, bothering people. And we always ended up at Denny's. And everyone always had, like, you know, $5 or something. And, you know, we could pull together to get, like, I don't know, fries or something. I don't know what we did. Oh, man, Shoney's. That buffet is on point. The buffet, when it says all you can eat, most people see a sign. I see a challenge. when I think about, like, trashy buffet, I think of the old country buffet. Yeah? You know? Old country buffet and, like, you know, like, all the stuff that you want is always, like, empty. And there's, like, one dude in the corner that just has a plate full of mashed potatoes. Only mashed potatoes. That's old country buffet is there. I remember when I lived in the Northwest and we were just a couple miles south of the Canadian border. A lot of the Canadians would come over to like buy groceries and stuff and they'd say, go to restaurants and do that whole thing. And we were in line at old country buffet and me and my, you know, very cheap, poor roommates. And, there was a bunch of people online in front of us. We just assumed they were Canadians. And my friend loudly said, you know, first, you know, they tried to take over our country and now they try to take our old country. And, you know, like four heads turned around, all the guilty Canadians turned around to look at us like, oh no, we're invading their old country buffet. That place is garbage. All right. Load up on bacon, biscuits, and gravy. you guys know how to buffet. I don't have to tell you. Where are we? Seems like this might be like a back and forth little slidey move. Yeah, it looked like we were doing that move twice, huh? Dude, I like this. I like this workflow. We transcribe a little bit, we talk about Shoney's a little bit. I think this just comes in right away. And this is like syncopated across the bar line. I think it sounds more like that to me. Thank you. yeah. Da, 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 da. Chromatic. I feel like I'm hearing it go down now. Just straight like that. Da-da-da-da-da. Ever been to a Ryan's buffet? Ryan's buffet. They got the salmonella salad, mystery meat, and I have no clue what I just ate, cake. Okay, let's find out about Ryan's buffet. Ooh. No, I don't know of this. Is this a chain? I think that might be a local to you thing, man, which I love. The Ryan's went out of business where I used to live in North Georgia. Oh, bummer. Mason could have checked that out, or like Jim Pankey could have checked that out. Could have reported back on the quality of the Ryan's buffet. Ryan says, just got some bad news. My colleague needs a neck reset. Anyone know how much this could affect the tone? Man, if you take it to someone good, you know, they'll take care of you. You might not, you know, I mean, lots of guitars get their neck reset, is what I'm saying. In fact, guitars of a certain age are just assumed to have to get their neck reset. If you have a guitar for like 40 years or 50 years, I mean, eventually it's going to need that work done. So both of my main Martins have been through neck resets, and they still sound the same. I wouldn't stress too much as long as you have someone good to take it to. Which is better, Ryan's or Golden Corral? Man, that is, I assume you're picking the lesser of two evils there. And I'm not sure there is a lesser in that situation. Martin had a reset about 30 years ago and it did not affect the tone that I could hear. Oh yeah. Russell told me about that. They have Ryan's in Kentucky. They may have completely gone out of business. Well, that's just a shame. We can never experience the greatness of the I have no idea what I just ate cake. Collings are bolt on, just needs a shim. Oh, they have the what's it called? Tennyson 10 something. I know what you're saying. There's a specific name for the bolt on acoustic guitar neck. Someone knows it. Mortison tenon, something like that. Fortunately, I live near the Collings factory. Mine is not a bolt-on, it's an older one. Oh, I see. Yeah, man, if you take it back to them, I mean, you're taking it to the best place. Russell would go to the Golden Corral. Maybe we could have like a vote. Here, let's toss in a couple. Golden Corral. We'll hit him with the Shoney's. Classic Waffle House. Let's see, what else? We had some good restaurants we were bringing up. Can't remember them. you know, we'll toss Ryan's on there. Why not? All right. You all weigh in. Yeah, some guitar manufacturers have like courses to be certified, but I assume, well, I guess they assume that you already have some basic luthier skills. I don't think they teach you from scratch. What time are we going? After the stream, we'll all meet at the Waffle House by my house. So far, Ryan's Buffet has received a total of 0 votes. I mean, Loco Joe's got the right idea. That's how you do it. It seems like Waffle House is the end all. I should shoot a video in the Waffle House parking lot. We'll do the next, you know, Billy Strings tutorial out there. Thanks for that important piece of crowdfunded information, everyone. That helps me a lot in my life to know how we feel about those restaurant chains. Chromatic again. That's hip. Perhaps a picking circle in the Waffle House parking lot. That is an idea, man. Waffle House jukebox is the bomb. You may have missed my story about climbing behind the Waffle House jukebox. No one wants Ryan's. Yeah, I hear you, man. I've never been to Orion's, but based on your description, I'm not sold. Jacob, I think a lot of people do apprenticeships. If you find a local person that works on guitars, you might be able to do some unpaid labor or something. Waffle House may have crappy service, but that's everywhere. But is any other restaurant, are you going to see an employee go at someone with a handful of butter knives? Yeah, that is part of the charm of Waffle House. See someone assault someone with a dull the dull knife. You gotta be a Waffle House, you know? The only one of those places I've had in recent enough times to remember is Waffle House. I'm sorry, Mason. Actually, you know, I hope your Waffle House experience was great. Yeah, Mason, you got time, man. You got time to experience Shoney's. You got time to experience Applebee's, Denny's. Just take it all in, man. You got time. How do we feel about Red Robin? Now, that's a restaurant. I don't even want to hear what you guys have to say. Let's just pop this in. Red Robin, question mark? Let's go someplace nice. How about the Red Lobster? How about Outback? We get a Bloomin' Onion. You know what I'm saying? What's a Red Robin? Red Robin is like a burger joint. It's like mid-tier in terms of chain restaurants, I would say. A solid mid-tier, though. I mean, no one's drunk or undressing. Yum. You get an apprenticeship working for free and support yourself working as a cook at Waffle House. That's what I'm talking about, Gregory. Never have been to or even seen a Red Robin. I think they started in the Northwest. I think they're like a Seattle thing, maybe a Portland thing. But they have them. They have them everywhere. I think they're all across the country. I had Red Robin about 10 years ago. I remember it being good, but I liked everything back then. In-N-Out is the goat burger joint. That may be true. That'd be blooming great, Marcel. Man, 25% of you said no to Red Robin. Wow. This is the weirdest stream, man. I want a job as the Waffle House taste tester. Said no one ever. Red Robin puts eggs on burgers. It's wild. That should just be a Red Robin ad. It's just a black piece of paper. It all says is Red Robin puts eggs on burgers. It's wild. And it's like in the middle of a magazine. Who else has got a restaurant? Who's got other restaurants we can talk about? This is the weirdest stream, man. Marcel, at least every other stream. It's true, man. We just get into these weird conversations. I don't know how it happens. Mr. Burrito is super good. What's Mr. Burrito? Wait, what is Mr. Burrito? You can see me Googling up in the corner. Hilarious. Yeah, I'm seeing Mr. Burrito. I gotcha. I getcha. Where do I have to go to get to a Mr. Burrito? Looks like there are some in North Carolina. We could go to Mr. Burrito, guys. But only me and Jim go there, really? Oh, yeah. I feel like I've seen this. Scratch and sniff egg pop-out ad. That sounds terrible, Jim. That sounds awful. this is a catchy tune from what I'm hearing. It's good. We're just being interrupted by this whole restaurant conversation. Mr. Burrito, is that a chain? I may have seen that out of state. He's just one place. Oh. You guys ever been to Taco Time? You familiar with Taco Time? Right. I know this move. This is a little triplet. It's all slides. He does this in Shadows. Like that. I'll just start writing this so I remember. For burritos, I like Del Taco. Man, there was a really good Del Taco in my old town, and it was like a Slovenian dude or something. It's like weird, like unexpected nationality for a Mexican food restaurant, and he made the best burritos. As soon as he left, the place just went downhill. He was the real magic behind that Del Taco. Chickens are vicious. Don't trust a chicken. Don't trust a chicken, because a chicken won't trust you. chickens like boiled eggs. We can boil up some eggs and throw them to chickens, and they act like it's the most amazing thing they've ever seen. That's a little, like, cannibalistic, ain't it? Feeding an egg to a chicken? I don't know. I don't know about the ethics of that one. I feel like chickens are actually pretty nice in my experience with chickens. They're not. Chickens are usually sweethearts. Yeah, Mason agrees with me. Our chickens love to eat chicken. My chickens don't like me. What are you doing to the chickens, Aubrey? Our chickens will start eating the dead ones when one dies, so I'm not sure our chickens ever did that. I bet they would have. Taco Cat, spelled backward, is Taco Cat. Thank you, Billy. They're like little raptors. They are. Isn't that what they said in Jurassic Park? Or no, they said turkeys, right? He's talking about turkeys. And then he like slices that kid. Yeah, totally. When I look at a chicken, I see a velociraptor staring back at me. What kind of chickens are you dealing with there, Jacob? Let's do a tie right here. I think we're dealing with this. This wrong. Yeah, this seems like it's like this kind of pull off. Yeah, let's get rid of all of this real quick. Is he shifting back? It's just not a pull off. and they just like continue like that. Something like that. Okay. Cannibalistic chickens. Thanks for the nightmares, guys. You got some Donner Party chickens there, Mason. It's funny. Bluegrass chicken lay their eggs on the sunny side of the mountain. Chickens lay their eggs wherever the hell they want, man. They do not lay in their little bins. You want them to, but they don't. My chickens are fascinated by banjos. Mason, where is the chicken banjo video? Is there already one? Why haven't you posted a video where you play banjo for your chickens? Side note, I just love how the transcription work kind of has become the background task. It has. Today we're talking about other things. it's a bit surreal. I think it's pretty fun. I think it's funny. it's about the chat. We just transcribe, you know, on the side. Am I the only one that got creeped out by Chicken Run as a kid? Yeah, I feel that. I get it. I was creeped out by Brave Little Toaster, man. When they go into space, that was too much for me. I was not into the second Brave Little Toaster. First one's all right. Second one, they meet an alien, man. That's not cool. That's crazy. I don't want to think about aliens. That scared me. we have an important discussion going on here. We do. We do indeed. some roosters are scary. Yeah, I seem to remember our rooster getting a little feisty. But I don't remember super well. We gotta be getting close to the end of this break. Da-da. And then it seemed like you did the same thing again. Da-da. Maybe it was slightly different. This one went down again, maybe the same way as last time, where he skipped that note. Whispers. If I was Tony, I mean, it doesn't exactly sound like this, but I'll play that down there. Whispers of... Whisper. Yeah, this one goes all the way down this time. I bet he plays it down there. And that clears up that mystery. There's the tune. Am I going to play the whole thing? No. But we will put it on the website at some point. let's see my work. All right. Thanks for that suggestion. Was that, I think that was Michael Mark. It was seconded by someone, maybe Jacob. Thank you for that suggestion, guys. I appreciate it. Can we tab out the slap, please? Is there a slap? Don't think we will get 3 transcriptions done today. I think we're done transcribing for the day. We spent all our time talking, which is fun. I'm not against it. let's see. How about the 4 of you who have not clicked the like button? Do so, thanks. Yeah, what are y'all doing? You guys sleeping on the like button? Hit that like button already. Hit subscribe. You're all probably subscribed. I know all of you. I know all of you on first name basis. So we're good. If you're watching the stream and I don't know you, hey, say something in the stream. Wallace and Gromit can get pretty creepy. Yeah, I feel you on that. I feel you on that. The cheese moon thing. It's a little much for me. Do you know that studio burned down? Because it did. My grandmother had a rooster who would fight an electric fence. He was mean, but is evident for fighting a fence, not too bright. That sounds like a rooster. Marcel, do you have any electric guitars? Yeah, I do. Not used to you without your hat on. See, you know, someone asked for the hat. Someone asked for the hat off. Now we want the hat back on. It's fine. We can go back to the hat. Actually, I don't need these anymore. We have a nice rooster named Strut. He has 15 ladies all to himself, which is probably why he's nice. He'll be like, I don't think we're going to get to your suggestion. I'm sorry, man. We kind of took on a big one, and then we got distracted today. So next time. Hold your suggestion for next time. We will do it. Talk later. Love the Black Ray Velocifit. Yeah, man. Glad you liked it. Yeah, and no problem giving you this tab. If you ask in the Discord, too, I'll hook you up with it early so you don't have to wait for it to be on the website. Who asked if I had an electric guitar? Someone asked. Ryan, maybe?
Yeah.
Here's my telly. This is the one that I normally play when I play electric guitar stuff with my obnoxious America strap. But yeah, man, I'm not going to plug it in right now. My amp isn't plugged in because I'm running the humidifier. But sometime, if you ask again, I'll play it on stream. That video was fun, Aubrey. You should play in the next one. Yeah, Aubrey, what are you doing? Don't sleep on the Bluegrass Coalition. Play on the next one. No, I'm not good at that. Aubrey, I don't feel like we've met. Nice to meet you. My name is Marcel. We would love to have you participate in the next Bluegrass Coalition video. Do you have a good exercise for upstrokes? You can make a lot of your own exercises by just counting, right? If you think of 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and as down, up, down, up, down, up, down, up. Now all you have to do is delete certain strokes. So for instance, you would delete all the downs. Up, 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 up. Or you could delete maybe only the third down. Down, up, down, up, up, down, up. Right? You can create all these different rhythms and they'll get you used to feeling down, up as, you know, as how the rhythm works. So you could delete, you know, the first down and the third down. Up, down, up, up, down, up. And you can create all those rhythms to practice. You can play them on your instrument with your pick strokes. You don't have to just speak them like me. But there's a trick. You play electric guitar on your album? I do indeed, man. If you want to hear me play electric guitar, you got to check out that album. It's called Traitor. It's on all the streaming services. Let's see. Yeah, sorry again, Hillbilly. But thanks for showing up. We'll do it next time. That's a pretty telly. Thank you, Mason. I actually got it for a gig. I was going to play with a country band forever ago, and the gig didn't work out, so I just ended up with a sweet telly. It's a good excuse to buy one. But yeah, there's some videos of me playing the telly on Instagram, too. You can check those out. I made a commercial for Red Rooster Wine in the 70s. Wait, Russell, you can't just leave it at that. You got to tell us more about this. Tell us about this wine commercial. I have a Strat. That was when I was into rock. Should have got a telly. Yeah, I know. I hear that story. What's the worst gig you've played? Now that is a question. The worst gig that I've played. One time I showed up at a restaurant. This is on the way to Mount Baker. So like, you know, like a kind of like a ski resort situation. And on that winding road there, one of these like nowhere towns that you drive through, there's a restaurant that wanted a band to play and we got booked for it. And they said they had a sound system and we were like a 4-piece band. And we showed up and their sound system was like a little, you know, like speaker like this big, you know, like a speaker you could plug an aux cord into, that kind of thing. And they had one microphone that plugged into that speaker. And we hadn't brought our own sound system because they said they had one. Now, the restaurant was like the size of a shoebox, and it had like 2 tables, and no one was in there. It was empty. And we took up half the restaurant, just the band, and we couldn't use the sound system. Now, they only had the one microphone, and they insisted that we use it. So we just kind of set it up and then played next to it. And, you know, we moved it to the side, and the owner would come out, put the microphone in front of us again. It was an awful gig. And I think the only person that showed up for it was my mom, which was super cool. So we played for the kitchen staff and for my mom, and it was a three-hour gig. And the only good thing that came out of it was when we were packing up after this terrible gig, I had already loaded up my mandolin player's mandolin. And I turned to him and I said, "Man, that guy took off with your mandolin." And his face just immediately turned to rage. He was like, he was ready to go like tackle some dude. And I immediately had to like cut the joke short. I was like, "Nope, I loaded up your mandolin. Everything's okay." So it was like it was a goof that existed for like 2 seconds before I was like, "Oh, I've gone too far." we had a good laugh about it. But yeah, that was probably the worst gig ever. I was miserable in that place, and it was so embarrassing to sing all those songs, just sit there. We should have just packed up and left, but I think that they had agreed to pay us, you know, $700 or $800 or something, so it was a good split between us, and that's why we stayed. But ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. I hated that. Canadian Brett here. Been a long time. Hope you're doing well. What's up, Canadian Brett? Yeah, dude, come back whenever you want. Let's do another lesson. I love it. I love that you remember your Canadian Brett. At the time when Canadian Brett was taking lessons, there were two Bretts. And I got them mixed up one time or something. And he clarified that he was Canadian Brett. And that just kind of stuck forever. don't think I ever heard you play Turkey in the Straw. Well, you're going to have to look harder, man. I don't think I'm going to play that one right now. I think we're about to call it, honestly. Although I do play Turkey in the Straw in my video about... maybe the one about pick strokes, fixing your timing with your pick strokes. And there is a video where I'm talking about chord tones, and I use Turkey in the Straw as an example. Can't remember which one it is. But anyway... I dropped my Martin D35 during the commercial. I had to send it to Martin to get the back put back together. A little like Humpty Dumpty. You never told me that story, man. You're in a wine commercial and he dropped your D35? Wild. Yeah, you're going to tell me more about that when we have our lesson. I want a Martin D45. Marcel, that is your cue to start pass the hat around. Dale said he's paying for all of our instruments. So, yeah, just submit your order to Dale and Dale will take care of it. I heard him play Turkey in the Straw Friday. Play Turkey in the Straw myself. Yeah, I see what's going on here. To Andy Hatfield's arrangement of Turkey in the Straw. He has great work with that tune. dare you play Turkey in the Straw 12 tone though? I don't think so, man. What about whole tone Turkey in the Straw? Can I think through that quick enough? I don't think I can, man. Man, that would be great though. Here's the whole tone G run, right? Instead of Town is has yet to catch on. I don't know if there's a guitar break in it, but I'd love to start the melody to Kenny Baker, First Day in Town, just putting it out there. Yeah, we can do that. I've thought about that before, of us just taking a tune that's not a guitar one and creating a guitar kind of arrangement for it. I got paid $100 to play at a wedding once. Does that count as a gig? Hell yeah, that counts as a gig, man. All right, gang. It's time. It's that time again. I got to call it. I know we only did one transcription today, but we did a hell of a lot of hanging out, and that counts for something. So thank you for your opinions on Waffle House, for your opinions on Shoney's, for your opinions on the, you know, illustrious Ryan's Buffet. I really appreciate that. I hope you enjoyed me transcribing this arrangement while we talked about restaurants. We do this every Tuesday at 6 p.m. Eastern. Remember, you can get these tabs and a bunch of other ones at the website. Sometimes it takes a little while to post them. If you want to get those tabs early, if you want to keep hanging out with us, you should join the Discord. There's a link to do that in the description, I believe. It's also back in the chat if you just scroll up. If you want to keep hanging out at least for a little bit longer, I would like to invite you to join us in Forever Chat. All you have to do is stay in the chat while the stream ends, and there is this space in between worlds where the stream is over and we all hang out and still talk. Thank you all for hanging out. I see Matthew Miller, Hillbilly Guy, Russell, Travis, Jacob Stouffer. Thank you all so much for hanging out. I know Mason's over there too. I see Loco. All my buds hanging out. We'll see you next week. Have a good one, everyone.
So I'll do a count to lead it in. 1, 2, 3, 4. Prejudice to guitars that have plastic backs. Tighter sound. Tighter sound. Sound. It drifts away from the norm. Sounds very much like a dreadnought. Tighter sound. Tighter. couple of things I should mention now is that, first off, neither the rhythm through there nor the improvising part over the rhythm were what I...